Hi, everybody. Welcome to another episode of Just Kidding. This is a brand new episode of Book Reviews with me and my coworker Joy at the Worcester Public Library. Hey, Joy, how are you today?
Oh, I'm doing just fine. How are you?
I'm really excited for our new show. What about you?
No one improved. But as you said, you can't improve on perfection, but
we'll try,
right?
So everything Joy and I are talking about today is coming out this month in December 2020, or has already come out, but just a few days ago. So because everything's new, it is not on Overdrive or Libby yet, but these are popular, well-reviewed titles. You can put a hold on the print copy in the catalog before they're released, and hopefully they'll be on Overdrive and Libby soon. If you're not sure how to put a hold on anything, or you don't know about our pickup services, you can always call the library or put a comment below and we'll get back to you. So now I'm going to share my screen so you can see the new books we have lined up for you. All right, so as usual, I will be discussing the fiction. Joy will do the nonfiction. Take it away, Joy.
Okay, for my first choice for this new and improved version of Weekly Reads, I have chosen Dancing in the Mosque, an Afghan Mother's Letter to Her Son by Homera Kaderi, which just came out a few days ago. When Homera was a young girl living in Afghanistan, her father packed his precious books in a metal box and buried them in the backyard to avoid drawing the attention of the Taliban, who would have destroyed them. They were too secular for the Taliban. Every year, he took his books out for an airing and to check for damage, and then reburied them. It may not be surprising, therefore, that Homera grew up to be an activist passionately committed to women's literacy and to human rights. And it is probably not surprising that she eventually ran afoul of the Taliban and was forced into exile. This book is a mother's love letter to the son she left behind. In telling her story, she challenges you to reconsider the meaning of motherhood, sacrifice, and survival. This book has been described as a modern Sophie's Choice, a heartbreaker, but also a story of one woman's bravery, audacity, and strength. Kirkus calls it an unvarnished, memorable portrait of a mother's grief and love.
Okay, I also have a book about the Kabul area. All right, so my first fiction book here is The Opium Prince. This book just came out a few days ago. It's described as deeply informed and beautifully written. It's set in Afghanistan in the 1970s. Born to an American mother and an Afghan war hero, Daniel, the main character, has spent his life navigating a complex identity. After years in Los Angeles, he is returning home to Kabul at the helm of an agency dedicated to eradicating the poppy fields that feed the world's opiate addiction. But on a drive out of Kabul, Daniel accidentally hits and kills a young Kochi girl named Telia. He is let off with a small fine, partially because nomad tribes are ignored by the law, but also because a mysterious witness named Taj intercedes on his behalf. Racked with guilt and plagued by nightmares, Daniel begins to unravel, running from his crumbling marriage and escalating threats from Taj, who turns out to be a powerful opium con. Throughout the book, the author has included short, haunting fables, which are presented as children's stories, and disclose the brutal reality of Afghan life. This book got starred reviews from Booklist and Publishers Weekly. Publishers Weekly said, "This is a stellar debut. Amok, who is half Afghan and half Swedish, was a former arms control analyst and draws heavily on her childhood in Afghanistan to provide glimpses into the complicated political and cultural dynamics of a country that has seen nearly half a century of constant war. Her observations provide astonishing context to contemporary global issues such as Islamic extremism and the international heroin trade." I know I always joke about learning all my history from historical fiction, but I definitely get the sense that I could learn a lot by reading this novel. If you feel like me and you're interested in what is supposed to be beautiful writing, you can go ahead and put a hold on the print copy, or we'll just keep our eyes out for the electronic copy. Here's one from Joy.
Both the author and her book sound fascinating to me.
They really do.
A conversation over dinner with her. And speaking of authors, anybody recognize the woman in this picture? That's the immortal Tina Turner. Devon, have you ever heard her like belt out Proud Mary in concert?
Not live, unfortunately.
But have you? You've heard? No, you haven't. Oh, do it, fellow readers. If ever you've heard her, you know that she just exudes power in concert. Her personal life, however, has been something else. Over the years, Tina has endured adversity of all kinds, including domestic abuse and severe depression. But in this new book, she is here to tell you that she overcame a host of limitations, sorrows, and obstacles to find true happiness, and to let you know that you can too. Drawing at the age of 81 on a lifetime of experience, she uses the principles of her Buddhist faith to empower us with the spiritual tools necessary to find joy, stability, and prosperity as we each undertake our own journey. This book is full of inspiration and sage advice from a musical icon and one of my musical idols.
Absolutely. I can't believe she's in her 80s. She just seems ageless.
I know. And I wish she were. We want her around forever.
Absolutely. All right. Here's my next fiction book. All right. I have another historical fiction for you. This is Germania by Harold Gilbers. That is him on the right. This book also came out on December 1st. Gilbers is an internationally best-selling author, and this debut book of his won the Glaucer Prize for Best German Crime Novel. The book is set in Berlin in 1944, when a serial killer stalks the capital of the Reich, preying on women and laying their mangled bodies in front of war memorials. All of the victims are linked to the Nazi Party, but according to one eyewitness, the killer is not against Hitler's regime, but rather a loyal Nazi. Jewish detective Richard Oppenheimer, once an investigator for the Berlin police, is reactivated and forced onto the case. Oppenheimer is not just concerned with catching the killer and helping others survive, but also his own survival. When evidence surfaces that one of the victims was connected with Lebensborn, Himmler's program to produce children with as pure blood as possible, the investigation becomes even more delicate. But with no choice but to pursue his investigation, he searches for answers and a way out of this dangerous game. This book has starred reviews from Publishers Weekly, and it's set in a bombed out Berlin, a landscape that plays an important part of the story and makes familiar streets unfamiliar to people who live there. The Amazon reviewer said, "Hunting a serial killer who murders and mutilates women with connections to the Nazi Party is terrifying enough. But being a Jewish former detective strong-armed into the hunt by the Gestapo, that adds another layer of tension to an atmospheric, intricately plotted thriller that crackles with danger, betrayal, and death." This book sounds really intense to me, sort of like the thriller of thrillers. And of course, the historical fiction aspect is a huge draw. So if you're interested in this book too, you can place a hold on it. Since it's so brand new, I'm sure there are other people ahead of you, but I think it'll be worth the wait. Here's one from Joy.
And I am one of those ahead of you on the holds list. So get on there quickly. Well, my next choice is Yellowstone Wolves, Science and Discovery in the World's First National Park. by edited by Douglas W. Smith, Daniel Stoller, and Daniel R. McNulty, which will be released on December 7th. Okay, how many of us remember the Big Bad Wolf?
I do.
Remember how scared you were at the age of four when you first encountered the Big Bad Wolf? Well, don't worry, the Big Bad Wolf is gone. And I'm glad, because just look at the beauties in this image. Oh my gosh, they're gorgeous creatures. Mm-hmm. In the last few decades, the reputation of the wolf has improved tremendously. Whereas they were once best known for eating grandma for lunch and scaring Little Red Riding Hood, they are now considered by many to be wise, vaguely mystical creatures with a great deal to teach us about, well, maybe like raising children in community. So what happened to change the popular perception? Well, there is this. 25 years ago, one of the greatest wildlife conservation and restoration events or projects began, the reintegration of the wolf into Yellowstone National Park. This started in 1995 when the government reversed its extermination policy and began the reintroduction of the wild wolf. In the following decades, scientists studied their behaviors and built a one-of-a-kind field study. This is the incredible story of the wolves' return to Yellowstone as told by the people responsible for their reintroduction, study, and management. Featuring a foreword by the great Jane Goodall, beautiful images, and contributions from over 70 wildlife conservation leaders in the world, it has been called the definitive work on the subject. Goodall says it is an example of what can happen if human beings unite to give Mother Nature a chance. In an era plagued by climate change and the threat of mass extinction, this is a much needed story of hope and a great holiday gift for some of those you love, one of those you love.
I'm really interested in getting my hands on a copy of this. I'm sure the pictures were gorgeous.
I'm sure they are too. I can hardly wait. Mm-hmm. Maybe I'll buy it for myself for Christmas.
Yeah, why not? All right. And this is our last book of the episode. The Chanel Sisters. I am personally very excited for this one. It comes out on December 29th. The book is being called historical fiction and a fictional biography, and it's supposed to be perfect for all of you fashion aficionados. In the book, Gabrielle Coco Chanel and her younger sister Antoinette know they're destined for something better. Abandoned by their family, they've grown up under the guidance of nuns, preparing them for simple lives. At night, their secret stash of romance novels and magazine fashion cutouts helps them keep their dreams alive. When they're of age, the sisters set out, determined to prove themselves worthy to a society that's never accepted them. Their journey takes them out of poverty and to the cafes of Moulin, the performance halls of Vichy, and to a small hat shop on the Rue Cambon in Paris. But the sisters' lives are thrown into turmoil again when World War I breaks out. Part of the book, part of the draw of this book is its relationships between characters, between siblings, between friends, and between lovers. The book is also full of rich period detail, lush descriptions, and has a generous sprinkling of French terms, which I would personally find fascinating. If you don't like books that have different languages in them, this might not be for you, but if you're curious, I think you should give it a try. Author Elise Hooper said, "I loved this story of two ambitious women who dare to envision brilliant futures for themselves and refuse to settle for anything less. The author has created a fascinating behind-the-scenes look at the rags-to-riches rise of fashion's most intriguing icon." I also wanted to mention this book is being published just days away from the 50-year anniversary of the death of Coco Chanel. And that's Coco pictured there on the right-hand side of the photo. She's with her Aunt Adrienne. But that brings us to the end of our episode today. So along with this new format, we will not be back next week. Every first week of the month, we're going to be doing the new books show, featured new releases. And then on the third weekend of the month, we'll be back with staff picks. So don't look for us next weekend, but the weekend after that. And we hope to see you then.
And no getting rid of this, fellow readers, new format or no, see you later.